Ascent Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Harvard Business Review Project Management Handbook, How to Launch, Lead, and Sponsor Successful Projects, by Antonio Nieto-Rodriguez, narrated by Christopher Douyard. Publisher's Note: This audiobook has bonus material. Please contact whomever you purchased this audiobook from to request the material. All figures and tables referenced in this audiobook can be found in the bonus material. Introduction. Welcome to the project economy. The world is undergoing a massive series of disruptions, from the sustainability movement going mainstream to the rise of artificial intelligence, AI, to the maelstrom of the COVID-19 pandemic. Tectonic shifts are reshaping businesses and societies. Projects are now the most important method we have to turn these challenges into positive change. Projects change the world. They make impossible dreams possible. In my quest to learn more about what really makes projects succeed and fail, I've come across some incredible achievements. In 1961, the Prime Minister of a ruined former British trading colony envisioned a project to build an economically sound country that would be robust enough for future generations. It included establishing the rule of law, efficient government structures, overall stability, and a continuous fight against corruption and the development of human capital as the country's key competitive advantage. The project set uncompromising standards for a universally accessible, top-flight public school system and applied rigorous meritocracy to education and hiring in the public sector. Today, Singapore is one of the most competitive economies in the world. In 2010, a biotech company in San Diego began distributing the first commercially available body part printer after a project conducted at the company transformed a breakthrough innovation into a revolutionary product. Regenerative medicine laboratories around the world have since relied on OrganOvo's printer to generate pieces of skin, muscle, and blood vessels. An aging software giant made one of the most compelling turnarounds in recent history after a new CEO took over in 2014. The company had been unable to take the smartphone market from Apple, the cloud sector from Amazon, or search from Google. 5 years after Satya Nadella's transformation project began, Microsoft's share price had tripled, restoring it to the position of the world's richest publicly listed company. The list goes on. General Electric's spree of growth through 600 seamless acquisitions in the 1980s and 1990s under Jack Welch's leadership. Amazon's introduction of the Kindle, an affordable paper-like display device with access to the world's largest bookstore in 2007. Or the journey of DBS, the largest bank in Southeast Asia, to become the world's most innovative bank. All of these have been born from an extraordinary vision, clearly articulated and methodically implemented through projects. Think of the rollout of the euro in 2002, or the moment on the night of September 3, 1967, when Sweden switched traffic from driving on the left side of the road to the right, or the small Danish city of Odense, which, through an ambitious project, transformed itself into a leading innovative robotics hub in Europe, or Curitiba, Brazil's green capital and one of the most environmentally friendly and sustainable cities in Latin America. Some remarkably fascinating technological achievements in the past 100 years have been brilliant projects. John F. Kennedy's vision to send the first man to the moon by the end of the 1960s. The creation of the Boeing 777, a technological masterpiece in the aircraft industry. And Project Purple in 2006. Which built the first iPhone and transformed the telecommunications industry. Finally, there are countless amazing personal projects, achievements reached under extremely adverse conditions or simply personal dreams that become reality through a project. Consider 27-year-old Brazilian entrepreneur Elisa Mansour, whose startup won the 2018 World Bank Youth Summit Project Competition. Recognizing the chronic shortage of nursery care in her home country, which sees around 2 million infants and toddlers yearly denied access to this critical start in their lives, Mansoor set up a network to provide community mothers with training, organization, daily schedules, and a rating system. In doing so, she established a process for improving early childhood education and created a brand new Brazilian job market. Or Boyan Slat, who, as a 16-year-old from the Netherlands in 2010, took his first scuba dive off the coast of Greece and saw more plastic than fish. 3 years later, he launched the Ocean Cleanup Project with just €300 in seed money, with the goal of removing 90% of marine plastic pollution by 2040. Stories like this show the impact that the younger generation can have through projects to transform their world. Project-based work is the engine that drives change and progress. Projects generate the major accomplishments of our civilization. They stimulate society to advance beyond what things are and how they are done, and even to surpass long-established scientific and cultural limits. Even so, until recently, projects have often been invisible, and project management has been underappreciated. This below-the-radar character changed in 2020, when the global pandemic brought projects to center stage, the most amazing of which was the development of COVID-19 vaccines in less than a year, a process that usually takes more than a decade. But closer to home, countless change efforts were taking place. At work, in our personal lives, and on the news, projects were suddenly everywhere, and we were part of them. Projects were hidden no more. The pandemic made clear that we are all project managers, and leaders are all executive sponsors. From a world driven by efficiency to a world driven by change. Do you have any doubts? Are the various products, initiatives, and transformations just mentioned truly projects? They have more in common than meets the eye. Projects are limited in time. They have a start and an end. They require investments, capital, resources, and human resources. They are made up of a series of activities included in a plan designed to generate a deliverable, a product, a service, an event, that will ultimately create value, benefits, and other impacts. Some elements of each project are unique. Every project contains something that has not been done before. Now think about how projects differ from operations. In 1908, Henry Ford transformed car manufacturing from mere skill to industry with the launch of the Model T, perfecting the mass production of automobiles. 3 years later, mechanical engineer Frederick Winslow Taylor presented his theory of how to improve worker productivity by determining how a task could be performed more efficiently. Together, these are the landmarks of the beginning of the efficiency-driven world of operations. Higher volume, lower cost, increased speed, reduction through specialization and division of labor, and standardization determined how businesses were run throughout the 20th century. The chief operating officer, COO, emerged as a preeminent leadership role in most organizations. According to Robert Gordon, U.S. productivity grew the fastest between 1928 and 1950, a phenomenon he dubbed the One Big Wave. In the 50 years that followed, productivity in operations continued to increase by 2 or 3% each year. Right after the turn of the new century, however, something flipped. Since 2007, productivity growth has been almost flat in the Western world, despite the explosion of the internet, shorter product life cycles, and exponential advancement in AI and robotics. Productivity stalled because change cannot be implemented with traditional efficiency methods. Change must be implemented through projects, and the world is starting to take notice. The rise of the project economy. Projects are now becoming the essential model for creating value. Among German companies, for example, approximately 40% of the revenue and other activities are done as projects. Similar percentages can be found in most Western economies, and the figures are even higher in China and other leading Asian economies such as Taiwan and South Korea, where project-based work has been an essential element in their economic emergence. Since around 2010, amid the increasing projectification of work, project management has grown into one of the United Kingdom's largest areas of business. With an estimated 156 billion pounds in gross value added to the UK economy by project management, and with 2.13 million full-time equivalent workers, this trend is likely to continue. Research carried out by PricewaterhouseCoopers and the Association for Project Management concluded that the profession makes a more significant contribution to the UK economy than does the financial services sector or the construction industry. The same trends are occurring in the public sector. In 2016, the U.S. Senate unanimously approved the Program Management Improvement and Accountability Act, which was signed into law soon after. The Act aims to enhance accountability into best practices in project and program management throughout the U.S. federal government, and to reform federal program management policy. The following year, the Queen of England awarded the Association for Project Management a royal charter, which recognizes the project management profession, rewards the associations that champion its cause, and provides opportunities for those who practice its disciplines. The pace of the project economy is only going to accelerate. According to recent research, the value of project-oriented economic activity worldwide will grow from $12 trillion in 2013 to $20 trillion by 2027. Add to that the trillions spent on COVID-19 pandemic recovery projects. These are millions of projects requiring millions of project managers and executive sponsors per year. Throughout industry, forward-looking companies and individuals are preparing for a massive growth of projects. One senior IBM talent executive told me, "Soon, in IBM, we will no longer have job descriptions. We will have only project descriptions." Mohammed Alabar, chairman of Omar, the Dubai-based giant, announced that his company would abolish all the traditional job titles as part of the company's shift to focus on talent, not titles, and increase project-based work. The decision was outlined to staff members in an internal email. "When you reach the end of this email, you will notice something different. I have no job title, and, from this moment onwards, nor do you." The implication of this change is that individuals are no longer defined by the department to which they belong, but on the projects on which they work. The Richards Group, the largest independently owned ad agency in the United States, removed almost all its management layers and job titles, leaving only that of project manager. A study from Microsoft using LinkedIn's economic graph analyzed all the data on LinkedIn that shows available jobs, the required skills, and the existing skills job seekers have. The graph revealed the current 10 most in-demand jobs that, LinkedIn predicts, will have staying power into the 2030s. Among these jobs is project manager. Executives are aware of the increasing importance of projects in their organizations. In a survey my colleagues and I conducted with 556 senior executives for this book, 78% of the respondents reported they plan to invest and build their project management competencies in their organizations over the next 5 years. Soon, senior leaders, managers, and employees, regardless of their industry, will spend at least 60% of their time selecting, prioritizing, and driving the execution of projects. All of us must become project leaders, despite never having been trained to do so. The path to becoming a project leader. The emergence of projects as the economic engine of our times has been little noticed, but is incredibly disruptive and powerful. We are witnessing an unprecedented transformation with profound organizational and cultural consequences. Imagine the benefits, both for organizations and for society, if we could raise the current low success rate of projects. Consider the additional trillions of dollars and the social, environmental, educational, and other benefits this improvement would represent. And the impact could be almost immediate. What's more, bold projects can give work meaning. Behavioral and social science show that working and collaborating on projects can be particularly motivating and inspiring for team members. When a project has ambitious goals, a higher purpose, and a defined deadline, people tend to remember them more clearly than they remember anything else in their careers. The moments they feel most proud of are the projects they work on, often the successful ones. but also the failed ones. I hope you'll walk the path of becoming a project leader with me. The idea that eventually became this book first came to me more than a decade ago, when I was fired from my job as a project management expert. I soon realized that senior executives didn't understand or appreciate the value of project management. They saw it as a technical discipline for IT and engineers, one not worthy of their time and attention. This attitude couldn't be more wrong. When executives ignore project management, their projects are less likely to succeed. Products launch late. Strategic initiatives don't deliver. Business transformations fail. The key to project success is having executives and project managers sharing the same goals, working together, and speaking the same language. This realization set into motion my quest to simplify the methods of project management and bring them up to the leader's eye view. Throughout this book, I draw on my experience as a leading practitioner in several global corporations, such as PricewaterhouseCoopers, BNP Paribas Fortis, and GlaxoSmithKline. I am also a former president of the Project Management Institute and am an advisor and academic at several top business schools, where I have taught thousands of senior leaders, managers, and project managers. I have worked on and examined projects from every point of view, and I want to share that exceptional mix with you in this book. I believe that anyone can learn to be a project leader, and that people of any nature and background can persevere against the worst conditions to make their dreams a reality through projects. Projects inspire us all. My plea for society, and the purpose of this book, is that organizations, leaders, politicians, and everyone else will build the competencies required to transform and thrive in the new digital and project-driven economy. The first project management book for everyone. As both a practitioner and an educator, I can do real-world testing to see what works and what doesn't. In my teaching, I have learned which concepts resonate with both executives and project managers. I've learned that if I want to keep everyone engaged and interested, I had to dispense with project jargon. I had to simplify the language and the project management tools and techniques to allow people to see how they could apply these approaches in their own organizations. This book not only provides you with a broad view of project management, but also gives you practical skills you can use today to move your own projects forward. Traditionally, books about project management have been complex and technical, developed by deep project experts, and written for project management professionals, often ignoring the wider population that must deal with projects. The more arcane these books become, the more that project managers and executives retreat to their separate camps. This book, instead, addresses the topic from an outsider's perspective in a pragmatic, case-illustrated, and hands-on way. It presents a shared outlook, a simple framework, and a common language for every stakeholder, regardless of your role of any project. It teaches project managers to think like executives, and executives to think like project managers. Another shortcoming with the existing methodologies is that they tend to stop at the project's deliverables, assuming that the benefits, value, and impact will materialize when the deliverables arrive within the budget, on time, and per requirements. In many project management methodologies, how a project's deliverables are transformed into benefits is a black box. This book starts with a project's purpose and benefits as the foundation on which everything else is built. I built this book on one more premise. Every project, regardless of the industry, the organization, the sector, public, private, or nonprofit, the methodology, agile or traditional, or whether it is personal or professional, is composed of the same elements that will determine whether the project is a success. These building blocks of the projects are all captured in the central framework of this book, the Project Canvas. If organizations, leaders, and other individuals focus on these elements and apply the associated techniques, project success will be almost guaranteed. The Project Canvas. The Foundation Domain. Purpose. Why are we doing the project? Investment. How much will the project cost? Benefits. What benefits and impact will the project generate, and how will we know the project is successful? The people domain. Sponsorship. Who is accountable for the project? Resources. Who will manage the project and which skills are needed to deliver the project? Stakeholders. Who will benefit from and be affected by the project? The creation domain. Deliverables. What will the project produce, build, or deliver? Plan. How and when will the work be carried out? Change. How are we going to engage stakeholders and manage the risks? This is the first project management book intended for everyone, no matter your level of experience with projects. The book addresses the challenges faced by both senior leaders and project managers, providing practical approaches and adapted tools for each role. It provides a new perspective on the project economy, shows you how to use some of the new opportunities offered by a changing world, and suggests how the future of work will be driven by projects. If you are an executive or another leader, this book will help you better understand project fundamentals. You will learn how to ensure that projects have a strong foundation and the importance of your role as a project sponsor. You'll learn how to increase alignment and buy-in from project stakeholders, and how to best support the project managers to deliver the project successfully. If you are a CEO, this book will help you weigh the importance of the projects and strategically align and prioritize your project portfolio. You'll see ways to better support your project teams, to create a more agile and project-driven organization, and to be more successful altogether in a continuously evolving world. Finally, if you are a project manager or if you work on projects, this book will teach you how to elevate your work to become more strategic and how to make senior leaders see the value of projects and project management. You will learn how to work with the project canvas to define projects more clearly. The canvas will also help you learn a less technical language to communicate about the project with the executive sponsor, the project team, and other stakeholders, increasing their buy-in and motivation. The canvas will also help you keep the project sponsor engaged, often a determining factor in project success. The book is composed of 12 chapters in 4 parts. Part 1, Project Fundamentals for Everybody, sets the context and provides universal basics and definitions. Chapter 1 explores the concept of organizational ambidexterity and how organizations are shifting from a world driven by efficiency to a world driven by change. In Chapter 2, we'll look at what a project is, its definition, origins, and different characteristics, and how to differentiate projects from the more traditional tasks. Chapter 3 describes the different techniques in project management, including agile methods, program management, and the mega project approach, and explains how to determine which approaches and tools apply. Part 2, the project canvas, is a step-by-step introduction to the main framework of the book. Chapter 4 introduces the project canvas and its 3 domains and 9 building blocks. Chapters 5 through 7 cover the 3 domains in depth: the foundation, the people, and the creation. Finally, Chapter 8 describes how to analyze projects using the canvas and how to adopt the framework in your organization. Part 3, Individual and Organizational Project Competencies, explores the capabilities needed to succeed in the project-driven world. Chapter 9 discusses project leadership, particularly the competencies for effective project management and sponsorship. Next, Chapter 10 explores the selection and prioritization of projects through a process and a governance structure that help increase transparency and control in your organization's portfolio of projects. Chapter 11 examines why organizations must become more agile and project-driven, and how they can do so. Finally, Part 4, A Better Future Through Projects, explores how project management will intersect with the megatrends that all organizations and societies are now facing: crisis management, AI transformation, diversity, and sustainability. As each of these trends asserts itself in the near future, the opportunities and challenges will be resolved in the world of projects. projects are designed to deliver benefits. That's the whole point. Every year, $48 trillion is invested in projects. Yet according to the Standish Group, only 35% of projects are considered successful. The wasted resources and budget and unrealized benefits of the other 65% are mind-blowing. Imagine a world in which most projects deliver the outcome that is intended. Or imagine if we could just improve the success ratio by 25%. This improvement would equate to trillions of dollars of value and benefits to organizations, societies, and individuals. The purpose of this book and the framework it proposes is to close that gap and to increase overall project success for organizations, governments, and individuals. Are you ready to take back some of that lost value? Are you inspired to launch a project to create a better world? Or do you simply want a way to make better sense of the countless projects your organization is running? If you answered yes, continue on. Part 1. Project Fundamentals for Everybody. 1. Projects Everywhere. From a world driven by efficiency to a world driven by change. A dramatic shift has taken place. We have left behind a century dominated by increasing efficiency, and we are living in an always changing environment and a massive proliferation of projects. This chapter explores how projects, rather than operations, are driving short-term survival and long-term value creation today and tomorrow. Organizations of all kinds are running more projects than ever before. Project management can no longer be ignored, relegated, or misunderstood. Everyone involved in projects at all levels of organizations, employees, managers, project managers, senior leaders, and CEOs, must understand this shift as they select, prioritize, and execute these projects. Operations run the organization, but projects change the organization. In a world driven by change, short-term survival and long-term results depend on organizational ambidexterity, a company's ability to exploit its current capabilities while simultaneously exploring new competencies. Organizational theorist James March describes exploitation as actions such as refinement, choice, production, efficiency, selection, implementation, and execution. Exploration encompasses knowledge creation and analysis of emerging and future opportunities. Other scholars have described organizational ambidexterity as the balance between efficiency and flexibility, or between incremental and radical change. Clearly, balance is key. Organizations that overcommit to exploration are likely to find that they suffer the costs of experimentation without gaining many of its benefits. They exhibit too many undeveloped new ideas and too little distinctive competence. A well-known example is Ericsson, the telecom giant that led to the development of the global system for mobile communications. At its peak, the company's R&D organization employed 30,000 people in 100 technology centers. Yet, there was considerable duplication of work, and the company failed to capitalize on its many ideas. With its R&D results leading nowhere, Ericsson had to lay off around 60,000 employees. Conversely, organizations that overcommit to exploitation are likely to find themselves trapped in a temporary equilibrium, prone to disruption, and wither away. Taken together, maintaining an appropriate balance between exploration and exploitation is a primary factor in system survival and prosperity. Research has proven that ambidexterity leads to higher performance and better implementation of strategy, yet no clear solution has been found to keep the exploration and exploitation in balance over time. Organizational ambidexterity in practice. Businesses are getting younger. The average age of an S&P 500 company in 2017 was 20 years, one-third of what it had been in the 1960s. Many organizations can no longer keep up with the pace of change. Part of the problem, I have learned in many conversations with leaders, is the abstract concepts and academic language of ambidexterity. Terms like exploitation, exploration, adaptability, alignment, context, and organic systems do not resonate in executives' minds. We need simpler language that everyone can understand. In plain terms, this failure to keep up with change stems from the tension between two business dimensions: running the organization, operations. This dimension makes up the core and legacy activities of the business. It includes processes such as sales, customer service, finance, manufacturing, and IT. Most of the revenues and fixed costs generated by firms from running the organization activities. These activities keep the company alive. If they stop, the company will quickly die. The focus of running the business is short-term. The objectives are mainly commercial, financial, and performance-driven. They are about efficiency, productivity, and speed. In academic terms, this dimension is exploitation. Changing the organization, projects. This dimension makes up the future of the organization. It includes all the organization's strategic and tactical initiatives, projects, and programs. Companies, including startups and governments, often have hundreds or thousands of initiatives running in parallel. Changing the organization activities create future value. The objectives are more strategic and closer to the vision, but the benefits are only achieved in the medium and long term and are less tangible and quantifiable than operational objectives. These targets aim at transforming the business to significantly increase growth and profitability. In addition, projects may be highly risky, and there is no certainty that the projected benefits will be achieved at all. In academic terms, this dimension is exploration. Focusing on both dimensions at the same time is a great challenge for senior leaders. Table 1-1 summarizes some key differences that leaders must consider. And to make it even more complicated, being successful in just one dimension on its own is extremely difficult. Manuel Hunsmans, Jerry Johnson, and George Yip investigated 215 of the largest publicly listed UK firms from 1984 to 2003. First, they looked at how well the companies could run their business over a long period. Out of the 215 firms, only 28 were consistently top performers in their business sector over the two decades. Among these 28 firms, only 3 made major strategic changes while performing consistently over those 20 years. And this research is a few years old. The balance between running a business and changing its competencies is becoming progressively harder. What's more, you have much less time to do it. Leaders are well aware of this challenge. One senior executive of Western Union, a market leader in the money transfer business, told me, "Western Union has been trying for a couple of years to change its business model to stay afloat, let alone grow, in a market which is facing increasing competitive, technological, and regulatory pressures. The ability of our management to execute the strategies they present to shareholders, business partners, and employees is a make-or-break factor. They are all aware. Still, it is so damn hard to make it happen." Simply put, the future lies with organizations that can manage and integrate both sides of run and change. Projects, initiative, programs. Leaders understand that these are the tools they have for executing strategic change. But most of these executives don't understand why their change projects are underperforming. The answer is simple. Executives need to devote more of the right kind of attention to projects and change. The reason they have so much trouble with this solution began in the last century. Table 1-1. Two competing models within every organization. Dimension. Period. Efficiency-driven. Running the organization. Present. Change-driven. Changing the organization. Future. Dimension. Objectives. Efficiency-driven, running the organization. Generate revenues, survival. Change-driven, changing the organization. Create a vision, purpose. Dimension. Culture. Efficiency-driven, running the organization. Command, control, discipline. Change-driven, changing the organization. Entrepreneur, collaboration. Dimension, focus. Efficiency-driven, running the organization. Efficiency, volumes, costs, products. Change-driven, changing the organization. Innovation, transformation, benefits. Dimension, KPIs. Efficiency-driven, running the organization. Commercial, financial, performance. Change-driven, changing the organization. Strategic. Dimension, plans. Efficiency-driven, running the organization. Business, operational. Change-driven, changing the organization. Strategic, roadmap-oriented. Dimension, skills. Efficiency-driven, running the organization. Deep expertise. Change-driven, changing the organization. Deep generalist. Dimension, key role. Efficiency-driven, chief operating officer. Change-driven, chief project officer. Dimension, financial basis. Efficiency-driven, running the organization. Yearly budgeting cycle. Change-driven, changing the organization. Project-based. Dimension, compensation. Efficiency-driven, running the organization. Operational results. Change-driven, changing the organization. Project results. Dimension, results. Efficiency-driven, running the organization. Predictable, tangible. Change-driven, changing the organization. High risk, intangible. Dimension, systems. Efficiency-driven, ERP, APM, DevOps. Change-driven, changing the organization. MSP, PPM. Dimension, process. Efficiency-driven, running the organization. Standardized, automated. Change-driven, changing the organization. Unique, non-repetitive, evolving. Dimension, structure. Efficiency-driven, running the organization. Hierarchical, rigid, silo-based. Change-driven, changing the organization. Adaptive, project-based, self-managed. Abbreviations. APM, Association for Project Management. ERP, Enterprise Resource Planning. MSP, UK-based Managing Successful Programs, a certification through an established program management framework. PPM, Program and Portfolio Management. The proliferation of projects in organizations. How did we get to this state where projects are so essential to organizations' long-term success? An overview of the history of projects can help us understand this evolution. Yesterday, the century of efficiency and operations. Since the 1920s, companies have been improving their running the organization dimension, operations, as a means of increasing productivity by becoming more efficient, reducing costs, and raising volumes and outputs. At that time, most companies were mainly producing goods, and growth was mainly organic. Companies grew by increasing production capacity, standardizing and automating processes, and entering new markets. Growth was achieved by increasing efficiencies and reducing costs. The management gurus of the day, Frederick Taylor, Henry Ford, Peter Drucker, focused on improvements in the running of the organization. Over time, since introducing changes required an effective way of managing them, improvements were carried out as one-off projects. The number of projects increased, marginally, but steadily. Many organizations, including publicly traded companies, operated on an annual planning cycle. Senior leaders collectively decided on strategies, budgets, and operating plans once a year, and then managed operations in accordance with those goals and cost limits. Between annual planning cycles, few major amendments were allowed. The yearly cycle shaped firms' processes, systems, and cultures. Companies organized themselves in hierarchical structures, creating departments along the value chain elements. Department heads would be in charge of resources, budgets, and decision-making power. To ride the wave of efficiency, employees had to develop a deep specialization and sole dedication in one particular area. An in-depth understanding of one specific area or topic, this characteristic is variously described as deep skills, core competencies, deep expertise, and specialization, led to an individual's increased credibility, faster climbing of the career ladder, and growing income. Professionals would be trained in production, finance, marketing, sales, and quality, among other areas, and would spend their entire career there. Roles like generalist and project manager had no great career potential and commanded little appreciation. Because of all these developments in the 20th century, companies have made their operations extremely efficient. But efficiency at all costs has enormous downsides. In many cases, organizations focused on the headlines, results in terms of numbers, with little thought to the medium or long-term impact this approach might have on an organizational innovation or resilience. Companies have commoditized their processes, sacrificing elements of value for speed. They have grown their businesses through acquisition, often at the expense of organic growth or as an alternative to it, to accelerate their product release schedules or just to produce more and more. But at some point, a strategy of more volume, more product releases, or more brand extensions simply runs out of road. Sustainable growth through further efficiency becomes impossible. Today, the world driven by change and projects. Today, every organization, public or private, operates in an environment subject to continual and sometimes disruptive levels of change. For example, political change can expose a business to new sources of competition. Markets may be opened or closed. New game-changing regulation might be introduced without warning. And there is, obviously, technological innovation, particularly associated with the internet and digital technology. To this can be added social shifts, with fluid customer attitudes to the environment, health, or social responsibility. Growing the business, boosting its profitability, or securing its continuation depends on anticipating, managing, and driving change, which in turn depends on initiating and successfully completing projects. Projects used to be temporary tasks, whereas operations were permanent. Now, changes are permanent, and operations are temporary tasks until the next change. Along with the increased digitalization of operations, it is much easier to find cheaper, better, or more competent partners to run them. Following this trend, Amazon Web Services, AWS, has become the world's most comprehensive and broadly adopted cloud platform, offering more than 175 fully featured operations and services. Millions of companies are using AWS to lower their costs, become more agile, and innovate faster. Even products themselves, now smart and internet-enabled, may develop new features and plug into new business models long after they are sold to end users. In line with the increased focus on innovation, collaboration, and agility, more and more work is being executed as projects. In 1982, 33% of revenues and 22% of profits came from new products. Just 10 years later, these figures had risen to 50% and 40% respectively, according to Booz Allen Hamilton research. The shortening of product cycles inevitably leads to a faster sequence of development projects. From the introduction of the first generation of the Volkswagen Golf in 1974 to the market withdrawal of the Golf 5 in 2008, product life cycles have been shortened from 9 to 5 years, a reduction of 45%. A study carried out by GPM Deutsche Gesellschaft für Projekt Management, German Association of Project Managers, and the EBS Universität revealed that in 2019, up to 41% of the German gross domestic product was produced by projects, and that there had been a steady increase since at least 2009. This extreme uncertainty generates a difficult operating environment for leaders and organizations. The yearly cycle that worked for almost a century no longer applies. the radically transformed circumstances call for new ways of working, more agile operating models, and new forms of leadership. Crisis-tested leaders will need to develop a tolerance of ambiguity, a quickened operating pace, and a culture of constant change. Organizational structures, processes, and systems need to be adapted, too, to ensure the sustainability of the organization and to take advantage of new opportunities brought by the deeply changeable world. Tomorrow, projects on the march. In preparing to write this book, I examined how these worldwide trends are playing out in real companies. In a survey of 1,284 executives and project management professionals, the majority of senior executive respondents indicated that the number of projects in their organizations had exploded over the last 5 years. Some 87% of the respondents had seen an increase in the number of projects, and out of these respondents, 56% had seen an increase of more than 25%. A full 25% of respondents said that the number of projects had increased by more than 50%. In many cases, these project leaders are overseeing 50% more projects as well. Of course, this growth is a double-edged sword, as the correlation between the number of projects and success is by no means direct. Organizations that overstretch themselves will find their projects starved of human and capital resources. Organizations that overreach with their projects will find that their lack of experience and capability will compromise the value of what they can generate. This meteoric growth of projects is affecting not only organizations, but also our professional lives and the very nature of work. The traditional one-company career path of previous generations is now a distant memory. This approach was later followed by one in which a person developed a career in several companies, often in the same function. Today, people not only switch companies more frequently than ever, but also switch functions, many becoming self-employed, moving to work 100% project-based. Digitization makes the switch to skill-based self-employment or even to hybrid employment, combining traditional and independent work, much easier. According to recent research, the number of individuals working in project-based roles in the U.S. will increase from 66 million in 2017 to 88 million, forecast 2027. This trend is likely to accelerate, and professional careers will become a sequence of projects. Roger Martin is a business academic who early on wrote about the transition to project-based jobs in his acclaimed HBR article, Rethinking the Decision Factory. He argues that one problem today is that careers and jobs are structured as if they were flat rather than spiky. He explained to me that in reality, they are filled with the peaks and troughs of projects. At least 80%, and perhaps as high as 95% of jobs are an amalgam of projects. But instead of thinking my life is projects, the average person in an office building thinks that their life is some sort of regular job and that the projects get in the way of their regular job. And so projects are put off and mismanaged. In fact, in organizations, the entire decision factory should be thought of as nothing but projects. Managers should organize their lives around projects. They should look more like professional service firms. Projects are routinely marginalized throughout the corporate world. Over the years, I have found that the word project is extensively used, yet largely misunderstood in private and public sectors. I have so often explored why companies have so many projects and why these companies often fail in delivering them or achieving any tangible benefits that a senior executive once told me, "If you want to make sure that something is not done, make it a project." Right up to the early part of the 21st century, the UK civil service was still largely staffed with highly intellectual people hired as policy thinkers, people who rarely thought of themselves as being part of a business operation. Project management and the capabilities it required had rather sneaked up on the service. The UK Cabinet Office published a seminal report in 2000. Successful IT, Modernizing Government in Action, included the first mention of the term SRO, or Senior Responsible Officer, to designate the senior civil servant with responsibility for a project. Anecdotally, The genesis of this report was an inquiry that was thwarted by the government's inability to find any civil servant who appeared to be in charge of an expensive and failing project. In the 20-plus years since the report came out, the Cabinet Office has made great strides in increasing the professionalism of the civil service by bringing operations onto the same level as policy, and by recruiting technical specialists to deliver projects. In 2018, an analysis by the UK's Institute for Government revealed that alongside the more than 160,000 operational delivery professionals, for example, those who run the prisons or operate the job centers, there is a whole host of cross-departmental specialists in the UK government. In addition to the 12,500 people classified as project delivery specialists, there were more than 10,000 digital and data specialists, 4,400 legal specialists, 4,300 commercial specialists, and 4,300 analysts. Many of these professionals will be making at least some contribution to government projects. Projects after the pandemic. On January 12, 2020, Ur Shaheen was having breakfast with his wife, Uzlem Tureci, and discussing a paper published in The Lancet about SARS-CoV-2, the virus that was circulating in the Hubei province in China. Both are doctors and co-founders of BioNTech, a German biotech company using mRNA technology to develop treatments for cancer. Understanding that the current epidemic situation in China could potentially become a global pandemic, Shaheen and Tureci decided that day to launch Project Lightspeed to use BioNTech's mRNA technology to develop a vaccine against this coronavirus within a year. Their project, like other vaccine development initiatives such as Moderna's, benefited from the unprecedented support from governments and regulatory agencies around the world. For example, Operation Warp Speed provided the resources of the U.S. federal government and the private sector to accelerate the testing, supply, development, and distribution of safe and effective vaccines, therapeutics, and diagnostics. Partnering with Pfizer, a world-leading pharma company, not only brought additional funding, but also provided expertise in late-stage clinical development, medical affairs, and regulatory aspects. Pfizer's expertise greatly facilitated interactions with the key stakeholders: governments, patient groups, regulatory agencies, the media, etc. Less than 11 months after BioNTech's launch of Project Lightspeed, and after several clinical trials with thousands of infected patients, the first regulatory approval for the BioNTech COVID-19 vaccine was given by the UK regulatory agency, Medicines and Healthcare Products Regulatory Agency. A few days later, the first patient was injected with the first Pfizer-BioNTech vaccine for COVID-19, thereby bringing to governments, healthcare workers, and other citizens around the globe the hope that this was the beginning of the end of the worst pandemic since the influenza pandemic of 1918. At the same time, Russia with Sputnik and China with Sinopharm had also developed vaccines at similar unprecedented speeds. The development of a vaccine in less than a year would never have happened if BioNTech had not taken a completely different approach to the development process, which traditionally takes around 10 to 15 years. BioNTech was the first vaccine producer to apply hybrid project management methods, mixing traditional and agile techniques, which we will examine in Chapter 3, to blitz through the development phases and clinical trials. Consider some of the key reasons for the success of this project. The project had a clear and higher purpose: develop a safe and effective vaccine as soon as possible to help the world overcome the pandemic. The benefits of the vaccine were clear and much higher than the investment. The CEO of BioNTech took the role of the executive sponsor, fully committed and dedicated to it. He allocated most of the company resources to the project. The relatively flat company structure, the short communication lines, and the biotech startup environment allowed organizational agility during an unpredictable pandemic that required regular changes in scope. The project team took calculated risks, namely using an existing mRNA technology and diverting it to a novel indication. The manufacturing capability of Pfizer allowed the mass production of vaccines before regulatory approval. The company's taking of this risk allowed immediate delivery to customers once approval was granted. Nearly all stakeholders had a high interest in and a high positive impact on the project. This level of engagement allowed for extensive coordination and collaboration. Procurement was facilitated by long-term relationships and partnerships, for example, with glassmaker Schott for the glass vials. For a time, the project legacy of the COVID-19 pandemic would seem to be the extraordinary feats of construction that saw hospitals, initially in China but then across the world, built from scratch in a handful of days. What may have a far greater and more sustained impact is the way individuals and organizations have learned to come together and collaborate in new ways to develop previously unimagined solutions to unanticipated problems, as demonstrated by the Pfizer-BioNTech vaccine development project. The pandemic has shown the world how project managers can deliver new ideas and change infrastructure and systems at an accelerated pace. In his 2012 TED Talk, Professor Eddie Obeng coined the phrase, "the world after midnight," to describe the moment when everything changed in business. For the majority of organizations, sometime during the first 10 years of the 21st century was the moment when the speed of change, technological, social, and environmental, outpaced their ability to learn. This moment left them with a problem. How could they thrive in a world full of exponential change? How could they cut through complex challenges? And how could they pass that skill on to their leaders, colleagues, teams, and clients? In many ways, the COVID-19 pandemic alerted us all that a new world after midnight had occurred. The new normal we sought for so long was in fact an ongoing state of continued disruption. More is to come. Disruptive technologies will accelerate this trend. Robots and AI will take over almost all the traditional administrative activities and operational work. Some of these roles, such as travel agents, bank tellers, factory assemblers, packaging dispatching clerks, and call center agents, have already disappeared or been completely reshaped. Through robotic process automation, routine, repetitive, data-centric activities are automated. Today, bots are behind the scenes, processing the majority of credit card applications. They can be programmed to easily handle all aspects of the process, including gathering information and documents, doing credit and background checks, and ultimately deciding if the applicant is worthy of receiving credit and issuing the actual card. Organizations will shift their focus more than ever to projects and project-based work. Projects are the new norm for creating value, or indeed, for simply staying in business. Projects are everywhere. We are now in the project economy. No matter your title or role, whether it's your first day on the job or you're the CEO, if you are concerned with how your organization creates value, then project management is now your concern. 2. What is a project? From product launches to digital transformations to mega projects. Everyone, students, business leaders, other individuals, and governments, uses the word project, yet it is largely misunderstood. There is confusion about what is and isn't a project, as well as the nature of what project management is. Since projects drive more and more of the value that organizations create, everyone, from coders to project managers to executives, needs to understand what projects are and share a common language about what project management does. Let's start by defining some simple terms. Definitions. Projects are limited in time. They have a start and an end. They require an investment in the form of capital resources, money, funds, and human resources, effort, time. Frequently, they bring together people who have diverse expertise and backgrounds and who have never worked together before. Stakeholders are the individuals, groups, organizations, or other entities that are affected positively or negatively by the project. Projects are made up of a series of activities included in a plan, which is determined and designed to deliver an output or a solution, a product, a service, an event, etc., that will ultimately create value. Some elements of each project are unique. A project is something that has not been done before. Agile projects apply agile principles, which have their origins in software development. Agile approaches focus on enabling teams to deliver work in small increments, thus delivering value to their customers faster. Because the team evaluates project requirements, plans, and results continuously, it can make changes rapidly. In Chapter 3, we will discuss the most common types of agile project management. Depending on their size, scope, or duration, projects can be categorized as programs or megaprojects. A program delivers a capability, that is, the organizational structures, processes, skills, or knowledge that enables new behavior.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.